calibration curve. So you put your calibration standards in there, and you do a linear plot like Beer's Law, and you have to have it be linear to 3 9s and a 5. Well, in PCHEM, that's pretty crummy. Look at this. 1, 2, 3, 4. 4 9s and a 6. And so the regression statistics for some of these fits are fantastic. Okay. And in fact, we can even go better than this. This is using the uncertainty value, the nu e, xe term for the lower state, which is not very well determined. If we look at the p values, so this is the regression output for a particular peak assignment in the iodine lab, and the ANOVA output, this would be the intercept, x variable 1, 2, 3, 4. These are the order of my columns. I had the columns that depend upon the upper state quantum number be first, the upper state quantum number squared is the second column, lower state quantum number squared. And so these were my four columns. These are the values. This is the standard errors. And then over here are the p values. So for the intercept, my p-value is 10 to the minus 151. So that's the probability that that random noise in the data gave me that electronic energy difference. Okay. Not very probable. I don't have that much noise in my data. But look here, this is the probability that noise in the data gave me my value for the anharmonicity of the lower state potential energy surface. So 57% probability that uncertainty in assigning the spectrum was enough to give me a coefficient of this magnitude. You can also see the ramifications of this p-value in the uncertainty column. So this is the value. And so if you ask me what my answer is, I would say 1.6. And you say, okay, 1.6 plus or minus what? And I said, well, 1.6 plus or minus 2.8. Right? That's, how much money do you have? $10? How certain are you? Plus or minus 20? Maybe I owe someone 10 bucks. Right? So that's the thing. If the probability or the p-values are bad, that's going to show up over here in your certainty. And so what we want to do is look to see what the uncertainty is in the XE term, because this is actually it's the nu E and the XE multiplied by each other, which are the coefficients of that quantum number column. And so what we want to do is take this number and divide this number out of it. So down here, these are the regression determined values. And then, so we take these regression values, and then we divide, like this one, we divide that nu e term out, and we end up with this xe term. And so this is the part, this is the term that's tabulated in the various literature sources for the anharmonicity constant. So this is not the anharmonicity constant. That's the anharmonicity constant times the vibrational frequency.
That's the one you were talking about that, but how did you get the DE values? And where to find the literature values for those?
There are several sources.
So I heard some people didn't seem to have something that correlated with the DE value.
It wasn't in the CRC? Okay.
I just looked at the thing online.
Yeah, so let's go. Let me show you. SHSU.edu. So here's the campus homepage. You come down here to the bottom right. The Newton-Gresham Library is always going to be on the front page of the university's website. That's one thing that they always, you know, you're not going to get the librarians to agree and get kicked off the front page. Okay, they want to be there one click away. So you come down here, resources, Newton-Gresham Library, click that. And the very first thing you have is what you used to call a card catalog, because every book had a little card in this little cabinet. And so you come in here and you can search this for the CRC handbook of chemistry and physics.
Can you
I think you have to be on a campus computer to get the CRC electronic resource. You could search the catalog, but to get to the full text.
I think you can download it.
Perhaps, yeah. So here it says CRC Handbook of Chemistry and Physics, 92nd edition electronic resource. So I'm going to click the online access button. And you can have the full download, which is kind of crazy.
You can do that from off campus, but on campus you can actually go to the CRC website.
Oh, really?
On campus computer and access the information.
Okay, cool. I'm going to do online reading, and I'm going to come down here. Molecular structure and spectroscopy. Ooh, we got our own section. Okay. And spectroscopic constants of diatomic molecules. So that's a table within this book. It's got some equations defined up front. Let's see if I can. I'm trying to get rid of this side panel so I can zoom in. No, you can't read it because I can't read it. I'm staring at the screen here. It's blurry. It's like it's trying to download a PDF image. But anyway, look at the columns and you'll see omega E and omega E X E. Well, our terminology is new. Theirs is omega, but it's the same thing. It's vibrational frequency. These would be the lower state vibrational frequencies. The upper state, we're going to have to get someplace else. But here's...
What's the title of this book again, COC?
Handbook of Chemistry and Physics.
Okay.
Does it matter edition? 92nd edition. You'll see it on the website. I thought I... Did I put on Blackboard a location of results? Question we're researching is where did you get the dissociation values, bond dissociation values? Okay, here's the data table from Hertzberg. That's an older resource, but it has all the information in it. And so here we are for I2 right here. And so you go to the top of the table and you see the in order. Here's the electronic difference and the terminology is TE. If you want to know what these different terms are, you can come here and read the preface of the table and it tells you what the values are. Omega E, omega E X E, omega E Y E, which we were not able to get. The rotational constant, vibration, rotation coupling constant, the bond length. And then what about the excited states? Well, you come down here to iodine. And so here's the iodine section starting right here, I2 127. And here's the X electronic state. And so then you have all of these values for the X electronic state. What's the excited electronic state that we're going to? Do you remember? So it's X, and then it starts A, B, D, E, here's C, and so on. And so then the B row would be our vibrational frequency, the prime values. So the X are the double prime values, and the B are the prime values. So you have all of those. Here's new electronic. And then scrolling up here. So these derived values are, yeah, they're calculated from the literature values. Okay. So in this lab exercise, in the lab manual, if you go to this the Hertzberg lab's not, I mean the Nibbler lab's not in there, so. Okay, well, we'll need to give you the equation for the DE. So that's a good question. It's just not in the lab manual. Normally I've included the Nibbler lab as part of the handouts for this, like I did for the carbon monoxide, and the Nibbler lab has the DE calculation or the equation in it. It's just not in the lab manual. So we'll get that uploaded. I don't have it on my folder on this profile. It's actually on my computer upstairs. So let me write a note to make sure that you have the equation for DE. It's really simple. It just relates the vibrational frequency and the anharmonicity, and then extrapolates it to where that anharmonicity causes the vibrational frequency to go to zero. Mm-hmm. And so that extrapolation gives us a value for DE. Okay. And so.
I think Nick gave two people in my lab, the people he stayed until we figured out exactly what he needed to do, gave us that equation, but
yeah,
I also had literature values that I don't know where they came from, and when I tried to calculate the literature values from the literature using the equation, I got a completely different result.
So yeah, well, we're going to be, this lab, because we're only doing V equals 0, 1, and 2 in the lower state, there are some values that should really be assigned to V double prime equals 3. And so that gives us a systematic error. We're going to be off. So we're going to be very precise in what we calculate, but we're going to have an absolute error. So we're going to miss the mark a little bit on these because we don't have an exactly accurate model because we didn't take into account the third vibrational level, okay, V double prime equals 3. And so let's look at that. Let's look at the ones, and then we'll do the derived values. So looking at this, this is our electronic energy difference between the two, the X and the B electronic state. So if you don't have in your mind this potential energy surface that we're dealing with, then this isn't going to make a lot of sense. But let's go ahead and draw a quick version of it. So this first value that we have in our intercept is this value, the difference between the X and the B state. And so that comes in at 15,000 wave numbers. Look at our standard deviation on that. That's fantastic. I mean, if you think about this, this is basically 10, so 15,000 plus or minus 10. So that's a pretty good uncertainty. If we want to take this and divide by that, we get our relative standard deviation, and then we multiply that by 100%, we get our coefficient of variation. So we have a 0.06% variation. Here's the literature value, 15,600, ours is 15,800. And so our accuracy, we're a little bit high by 0.9% high. So that's pretty accurate measurement of the difference between these two electronic states. Now, within each electronic state, we have the vibrational excitation, the various vibrational levels. And so this is the vibrational frequency with single prime. That's the vibrational frequency of the upper state. And so that's the difference between these levels up here. So that's nu e prime. Okay. And then nu e double prime is the vibrational difference down in the ground state. And so the double prime is 220. So 220 versus 129, you see they're quite a bit different in terms of their vibrational energy spacing. So the upper one has closer vibrational levels. Now then the uncertainty, or the anharmonicity in the upper state, we really don't have the anharmonicity constant coming out of our regression. We have this multiplication piece, nu e times xe. And we couldn't rearrange our columns to get xe by itself because it also depended on the vibrational frequency, and that was also something that our regression was needing to determine. So we couldn't put the vibrational frequency in a column and have this nu e, have xe come out front, because we didn't know what nu e was. So the regression gives us both nu e, the vibrational frequency, and nu e times xe, and then we have to divide that nu e from this product. So we take this value and divide by that value, and we get xe prime. And that's also in that Hertzberg table. And we get the uncertainty associated with it. And so this is 0.0076, and the uncertainty is in the fifth decimal place, and so we have about a 1% coefficient of variation in the upper state. Now, why do we have such good statistics in the upper state? Because this is an absorption experiment. And what are the differences in the peaks? Mostly just differences in levels that they're going to. We're starting at V equals zero and going to about 10 different states. Starting at V equals one and going to about 10 different states. And V equals two and going to about 10 different states. And they overlap. So we get multiple measurements of the differences in these states up here. And so that's why we have such good statistics in the upper vibrational level. So our coefficient of variation for the vibrational frequency was 0.4%. And then for this anharmonicity value in the upper state, 1%, plus or minus 1%. So those are very good in terms of our statistics in the upper state. We're starting from three different levels down here, so we do have some information about the vibrational levels in the lower state and the anharmonicity, but we really only have two differences, and to get that anharmonicity, we need to see that, are those differences the same or different? Right? The differences between the 0 and 1, is that the same or different as the difference between 1 and 2? And we're taking that small judgment and coming up with the anharmonicity constant. So that's very uncertain, and that's why our p-value was so crummy on that new EXE. You know, it came in, and here's the uncertainty associated with that new EXE term. The CV is 176%. So that's what I was saying. I have $10 plus or minus 20. Right? Doesn't make a lot of sense. If we go ahead and calculate that new EXE term, we get 0.0071 plus or minus 0.13. So that's like saying I have $7 plus or minus 13. So that's silly. 176% error. So we really should take that value out of our regression. So if you're in this situation and you've got this regression, trying to fit that term is assigning some of the noise to a term, and that noise may not be noise. It actually might make some of the other terms better. So having too many columns is like introducing garbage. And in any kind of modeling experiment, garbage in, garbage out. And so don't put that column in there and see if your regression improves. So then you would just redo the regression. You wouldn't have to change your peak picking. You just wouldn't use that column that's going to give you this coefficient. So you would just have three columns and the intercept. So you redo that regression. You only pick three columns for your x input. The y input is your vibrational frequencies and your transition frequencies. And so then this is the second regression without that new EXE term. And our regression has improved a little bit. So up here we had on our R squared value, 4 9s and a 3. Let's see which one. It didn't really change that much. 4 9s and a 3 and 4 9s and a 6. Sometimes it changes drastically when you pull a column out. Okay, so we got rid of the model for the new XE term, and our coefficient of variation here changed a little bit. It was 1 plus or minus 1%, now it's plus or minus 0.9%. So we got a little tighter measurement on that panharmonicity in the upper electronic state. Now let's go, how do we get this value here? Okay, this uncertainty in XE, and that's what I wanted to talk about this morning for propagation of uncertainty. Keep an extra digit, 797. Okay, so this is the data that we have from our regression analysis. And I want to know this, XE prime is equal. Okay, and then I want the plus or minus on it. So this is simple, right? This number is this number divided by that number, right? Because this is the product of this and this. So and so we can take those. And we do that, and we get this value here. Okay. But the question is, plus or minus what? Now, how do we take into account both the uncertainty in this value and the uncertainty in that value? We have uncertainty in the numerator and uncertainty in the denominator. We can't just pick one of these. And think about it, if I pick that one, it's bigger than this value. If I pick this one, it's the same magnitude as that value. So you know if we've got really good relative uncertainties here, relative standard deviations here, we ought to have a pretty good relative standard deviation here. So this is a multiplication or division type calculation. And so the RSD squared of the result, I'm going to go ahead and XE prime is equal to the sum. So I'll just go ahead and do it. RSD squared of nu E XE. So that's what you have. Whenever you have a multiplication and division, it's the RSD for your result it, squared is the sum of the squares of the RSDs of all of the pieces of the puzzle, okay? So everything that went into that calculation. And so this should be pretty easy now. We can calculate the RSD for both of these, okay? So we take the standard deviation and divide by the value. So let's go ahead and do that. So someone with a calculator can knock those out for me. Keep the guard digits in round at the end, okay? So 0.003972, and then this one?
Zero 04131.
How many zeros?
Just two, 0.004131.
Yeah. 4131. Yeah. And see, so they're about the same in terms of their relative standard deviation. And so this is a situation where you can't just assume that one of those is governing the uncertainty, right? They're both contributing to the uncertainty. They're both about the same magnitude. Another thing about relative standard deviations is they're unitless. Yes? Did you not get that?
No, I did mine wrong.
Okay.
That's for me.
Yeah.
Okay, which one do I erase?
I believe you erased.
Both of them? Okay. Let's try it again.
Mu E is 0.003972.
Okay. 3972?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
0.00815.
Okay. So, but still, even though this one is about twice that one, it's still the same power of 10. Where sometimes you'll look at this and you'll say, okay, this one is 0.008, but this one has four zeros in it. When we square these, they're even going to move further to the right. This one's always going to be higher, and so this is going to be the only term that really feeds into the uncertainty of the result. Okay, so sometimes you can just look at it and say, this uncertainty is so big, that's the only one I need to worry about. But in this case, no, we need to go ahead and add these together, square them and add them. So let's, so let's square them and add them together. So you square this one, or either one, doesn't matter. Square this one for me and then give me that.
0.00006643.
Okay. And then square this one. I'm going to just add them vertically. This is also going to illustrate, you know, if these are such drastic orders of magnitude different, you'll see that one will be really small. And so when you add them together, the biggest one governs. But notice these are again, the same power of 10. So you need to make sure that you account for both of them. So that's the RSD for XE, 0000, is squared. Okay, and so let's take the square root of this value. Okay, so this is the RSD for this value. And what are we trying to look for? We're trying to look for the uncertainty, sigma, or S, the standard deviation. So this is equal to S of XE prime over XE prime. So how do I get to S? I multiply by XE prime. Do you see that? So don't forget what RSD is. RSD is this, the uncertainty divided by the value. And so if I need to get back to the uncertainty, I just multiply by that value. Okay. And so S XE prime is equal to 0.00895 times the value I calculated here for XE, 0.007553. And that's in wave numbers. And so now our units come back. So our XE value will be in wave numbers. So that tells me now this is this value plus or minus 0.000067. Just let me line up my zeros. Do you see where the uncertainty is? That's fantastic. See, I have 1, 2 certain digits. I'm certain of those two digits. And then this is my uncertain digit. And what is the significant figure convention? You keep all the certain digits and one uncertain digit. Sometimes people keep two, but three is inappropriate. Okay. And so this tells us where to round. This tells us we can round here or there. Okay. So we can report this 0.007553 plus or minus 0.000067. Now there's several ways to write this. One is to write it just like that, where you've rounded here and you show all the leading zeros. Okay? But sometimes in the literature you'll see it written like this. Look at that and see if you can make sense. These things here and this are the same information. Can you see how it's the same information and how to use it? If you were to see this in a table, like at NIST for a particular physical constant, like Planck's constant, or the gravitational constant, or something like that, they'll write it like this sometimes. And you need to know how to interpret this formulation. What are they telling you? They're telling you that the value is 0.007553, and in parentheses they're giving you the uncertainty. And it's just meant to take the place value of the previous digits with all zeros elsewhere. Okay? So this 0.67 is meant to go in the place value for the preceding two digits. And you should be able to get this number right here by writing it this way. That's totally foreign. If you've never heard anybody explain it to you, you wouldn't know what to do with those two numbers. Okay. All it's saying is it's all zeros, and then you put these two numbers in the place value preceding the parentheses. Okay. So let me give you, I'll give you a couple of examples and test you with it. So don't know about all these digits, but I just made them up. I got the first four right on Planck's constant. But so let's say you look up NIST for Planck's constant. You're going to use this in your lab, so you want the most precise value, the most accurate value from the NIST website, the National Institute of Standards and Technology. And you see this. What's the uncertainty in Planck's constant? Here's the uncertainty value right here, and it goes right there. So S for H is equal to 0.000007 times 10 to the negative 34 joules seconds. You see, I have a 0 for every digit, and when I get to that 5, I write 7. And so that's the uncertainty given here. Now, can I simplify this? Yeah, I can. I can take all these powers of 10 and incorporate them into that power of 10. So let's go ahead and do that. This is 7 times 10 to the minus 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. So it's 7 times 10 to the minus 6 times 10 to the minus 34 joule seconds. And so then I just add those exponents. So that's 7 times 10 to the minus 40 joule seconds. So that would be my uncertainty in Planck's constant. So is everybody kind of feeling a little more comfortable with the propagation of uncertainty? If you've got a mathematical equation like this, you can certainly find the value that you're looking for. But now, what do you do for the uncertainty? Don't forget these relationships. Now, if this was addition and subtraction, instead of RSDs, you'd just have the straight uncertainty value squared. So you'd have S squared for the result is equal to S squared for the A piece and S squared for the B piece. And however many things were added and subtracted, you would add the squares of the uncertainties, or the variances is what they're called. If it's multiplication and division like this, then it's the sum of the squares of the RSDs, so the relative standard deviations. And that's necessary because sometimes these things are on different orders of magnitude, but the relative standard deviations may be the same magnitude. And it's also taking into account the units. These RSDs are unitless. You can divide and multiply things that have different units, but you're not supposed to add them, right? So the things that you add should have the same units. And so that's another thing that shows up. That took up most of the class period. I was going to do the MO diagram for ammonia just for curiosity's sake and practice. But let's do a Kahoot just to kind of log your how many what? In the workbook?
In the,
I don't know, because, I mean, if you're looking at all of mine, you're like, oh, gosh. No, I play around with this stuff.
Okay,
so I've got extra sheets. I've done regression two or three different ways and tried to put in the B equals 3 series or something like that. Just playing around with it over different years. And so, no, don't look at this and say, wait a minute, I don't have that one. Yes.
So Myers squared values just has maybe 2 or 3 9, so should I go back and
You might look at this DeSlanders table where you've got the differences and see if any of them stick out. Oh, we can't see. And so this DeSlanders table should have, you know, nice smoothly varying things starting at like 210 going up to 216, 217. If you're looking in here and you see something that's 300 and 95 or something where you've picked a peak or skipped a peak.
Okay.
And so if you skip a peak, that'll really crap up your regression real quick.
Okay.
And so that's, I would just check this table. If you can't find any problems in this table, then it's probably as good as you can do.
Okay.
Yeah. So, again, I played with this for a few years and pretty happy with it's bragging rights.
That is bragging rights.
Yeah. So let's go to Kahoot. Get your devices out. We'll do one on the fates of excited states. So a little bit of review. We might have already taken this one, I'm not sure. But I really mainly want to quiz you, but also log your attendance because you came today, and we want to make sure that you get the credit for coming. It's mental credit. Yeah. If you're short 10 pages, this will help. Oh, that's cute. I've got a little pilgrim hat and an apple pie. Could be any pie, but I'm projecting an apple pie. Absorption transition is forbidden. So we've got this chart here, but you can't see. This is S0 to S1, T0 to T1, S0 to S2, S0 to T1. So remember what this S and T stand from the Jablonski diagrams. And I'm not going to tell you. You'll figure it out. The term symbols, we've never done molecular term symbols, but the atomic energy term symbols, these letters are not related to that at all. No, that's a good question, because S could be, T would be difficult to figure out, but S could be related. So this is just a very basic shorthand to say a singlet electronic state or a triplet electronic state. How can a molecule change its potential energy surface? Internal conversion, intersystem crossing, radiative relaxation, all of these. An excited molecule emits a photon as it jumps from S1 to S0. This is called internal conversion, intersystem crossing, phosphorescence, or fluorescence.
I hate when your phone goes dead when you blink.
You punched the wrong one?
No, my phone's going dead.
Oh, okay.
Still there, though.
Okay, good. It's fluorescence, yes.
So I have one last question for the last question. So radiative relaxation was obviously one of the answers to all of the above. So each of those lines, so radiative reaction, relaxation is
would be a jump up or down. It could go up, it could absorb and change potential energy surfaces, or emit. Yeah.
And so each of those lines and each of the columns represents a different potential energy surface.
These lines here?
Yes.
Those are the vibrational levels and rotational levels. So this whole manifold is an electronic potential energy surface
okay.
in this whole column. And then these different things are just squiggles just to show there's a lot of vibration and rotational energy levels within the electronic potential energy surface.
Okay, and so if you were to map out the radiative relaxation on one of these diagrams, how would you do this?
It would be a line from one column to another. So it's jumping from one column to another and going down.
So
straight across would be the non-radiative intersystem crossing or internal conversion.
So it has to be diagonal?
Yeah, diagonal. Yeah, it would have to be diagonal, a big jump diagonally.
Okay.
Yeah, would be radiative. Yeah, that's good. An excited molecule emits a photon as it jumps from T1 to S0. This is called internal conversion, intersystem crossing, phosphorescence, or fluorescence. Emits a photon as it jumps from T1 to S0. From T1 to S0. Yay, phosphorescence, because we're flipping a spin and emitting a photon. So the triplet to singlet state is changed. We've got a couple questions left. Excited molecule moves from T1 to S0 without emitting a visible photon. Internal conversion, intersystem crossing, phosphorescence, or fluorescence. So it moves from T1 to S0 without emitting a visible photon. So that's why we call it non-radiative. It might be an infrared photon, but our detector is zoned in to the 400 to, 700 nanometer region, so we don't see it.
Is that the only reason why it's called a non-radiative?
Yeah. So we're looking at it in that visible region or UV region, and we don't see it, so it's non-radiative. But some people get confused because they think, but it emitted an infrared photon, that's radiative, but we don't classify it as radiative. So that's inter-system crossing because there was a switch in multiplicity. Which of these has the longest lifetime, slowest or least probable? Internal conversion, inter-system crossing, phosphorescence, or fluorescence?
So when it's radiative, what was it called again? Radiative emission.
And so it's phosphorescence because it has to flip a spin and emit at the same time, and that's least probable.